So today we are going to start reagents. So we'll be seeing some reagents like MCPBA, sodamide, lithium aluminum hydride, sodium borohydrate, diazomethanes. Some of the reagents we'll be using and its application in our day-to-day chemical reactions. So let us go for the first one. First one is metachloroperoxybenzoyl, that is MCPBA. What is MCPBA? Metachloroperoxy. Peroxy means it has two oxygens, one extra oxygen attached to the benzoic acid. If you see in meta, the chloro is at the meta position to your carboxylic acid, that's why it is called metachloro. Peroxy benzoic acid, because it contains an extra oxygen, reactive oxygen in it. That's why it is called metachloroperbenzoic acid, that is MCPBA. It is peroxycarboxylic acid and it is widely used as an oxidant for oxidation, conversion of sulfur to sulfoxide, sulfone. So such type of reaction this MCPBA is going. Nitrogen to N-oxides. So such type of reactions your metaperchlorobenzoic acid is preferred. The MCPBA is preferred over other peroxides because of its relatively ease of handling. It is not that difficult to handle. Okay? It is not that difficult. Like other acids are very explosive, peroxides are very explosive and corrosive. This is milder compared to other. The main uses are for conversion of ketone to ester, that is Baer-Willigers oxidation. So what is the first application? Conversion of your ketones to esters, that is Baer-Willigers oxidation. Epoxidation of your alkenes. So double bond is there, so you form a epoxy ring, that is your oxidase. Oxidation of sulfide to sulfone, oxidation of amine to amine oxides. So these are the applications of metaperchlorobenzoic acid. So the structure is benzoic acid with chloro at the perbenzoic acid with chloro at the beta position. Per means perbenzoic acid means your carboxylic acid containing an extra oxygen in it. So that is metachloroperbenzoic acid. Now let's see what is Baer's oxidation. What is Baer-Willigers oxidation? So this is an application of your MCPBA. So what is Baer-Willigers oxidation? Baer-Willigers oxidation is oxidative cleavage of carbon-carbon double bond. So what happens? There is a breaking of carbon-carbon bond adjacent to a carbonyl group. So the carbon-carbon bond adjacent to your carbonyl group gets, which is mostly in presence of ketones, to an ester or a cyclic ketone into a lactone. So you convert your ketones to your esters. So this is a method where a carbon-carbon bond adjacent to your carbonyl group gets converted into your ester. So it is carried out. So Baer is carried out with peracids such as MCPBA in presence of a Lewis acid. So in presence of a Lewis acid, okay, you like boron trichloride. So these are the hydrogen peroxide or MCPBA, which are used in MCPBA and chloroform in presence of methylene chloride. It gets converted to an ester. So here your ketone, if you see a carbonyl group, ketone gets converted to an ester. So this is a reaction in which an ketone group gets converted to an ester in presence of a peracid like MCPBA, in presence of a Lewis acid, to give you a corresponding ester. So this is Baer-Willigers oxidation. This is Baer-Willigers oxidation. Okay, what is Baer-Willigers oxidation? It's the oxidative cleavage of carbon-carbon bond adjacent to it. So if you see this carbonyl bond, it's broken. The bond between your carbonyl-carbon and your this thing is broken. And there is an introduction of an oxygen group in between that. So that converts your carbonyl group into an ester. So this is known as Baer's triggers oxidation, and this reaction takes place in presence of a parasite like NCBBA and a Lewis acid sometimes as a catalyst. So now let's go for the mechanism. What is the first step? It is the first step of this mechanism is your the per acid, whatever the per acid is present, it will protonate the oxygen of your carbonyl. So what is the first step? Protonation of your carbonyl carbon, as I explained you, the carbonyl carbon, which will be slightly having more charge. So it will undergo your protonation, okay, because of the negative charge which will be having, extra negative charge it will be having. So it will get protonated first. So once this proton is donated by your per acid, your O minus will be there, and the carbonyl carbon will get more activated, and it gets attacked by your per anion. It will get attacked by your peroxy acid anion. Okay, it will get attacked by your peroxy acid anion. It attacks on the carbonyl carbon. Okay, the next step is what attacks on the carbonyl carbon of your group. So this is a concerted reaction. So what is concerted reaction? Simultaneous breaking and formation of the bond. So concerted reaction is what? Bond is formed, simultaneously there is a breakage and making of a bond. So there is a concerted type of reaction, is one of the substitution on the carbon, on the ketone. So one of the substitution on the ketone migrates to the oxygen of your peroxy acid, while the carboxylic acid leaves. Okay, there is a loss of carboxylic acid, and one of the group migrates to the oxygen of your peroxy acid. So there is a migration of them. That is a concerted. One bond is formed, that is your ester bond is formed with the loss of a carboxylic acid. Okay, there is a loss of carboxylic acid, and your ketone gets migrated to the oxygen of your peroxide group, forming an ester. The substituents which are able to stabilize the positive charge migrate readily. So any electron donating which stabilizes the positive charge migrate more readily. So the order of preference is tertiary alkyl, cyclohexyl, secondary alkyl, phenyl, primary alkyl and methyl. So any electron donating group which will be favored, the migration is the rate determined. So this concerted reaction, where the migration take is the rate determining step of the reaction. And finally, protonation of your oxygen of your carbonyl leads to your formation of your deprotonation of your oxygen of your carbonyl group produces your ester. So this is your mechanism. So if you see that first step, look at it over here, protonation of your carbon. Then next step is what? If you see, the peroxy anion attacks on the carbonyl carbon. So you get your OH and this. Then what is the next thing? One of the group migrates of your ketone migrates to the oxygen. So one of the group of your ketone migrates to your oxygen of your per acid, leaving behind your carboxylic acid. And the last step is your deprotonation of your oxygen in your ester to give you in the complex to give you back your ester. So this is an Baer-Willebrand oxidation reaction. So what is the first step? Protonation by your per acid, then on the carbon, this leads to activation of your carbonyl carbon, then attack of your peroxy anion on the carbonyl carbon. Then the next step is what? Once this tetrahedral intermediate is formed, then it undergoes a concerted, that is breaking and formation of your bond simultaneously. So one of the group from the ketone migrates to your oxygen, and there is a loss of your carboxylic group from your per acid. So per acid, what is acid group is removed, oxygen gets introduced, and your one of the group from your ketone migrates to your oxygen of your per acid. So this leads to your formation of your protonated ester, which undergoes deprotonation, and you get your corresponding ester. So this is the process of conversion of a ketone, carbonyl ketone, to a corresponding ester in presence of an per acid. acid. Okay. So what happens in this case? So very important. The retention of stereochemical biomass. So the configuration remains the same. If it is a stereogenic center, the configuration of your stereoisomers will remain the same. There will be retention of your migration is concerted. What do you mean by concerted? By the departure of the living group. Step is the rate determining step. So what is concentrated? Your R group from your ketone goes and attacks an oxygen, simultaneously there is loss. So it is a concerted type of reaction where your migration and rearrangement takes place in a single step. Migrating group. So which type of groups will be migrating in your ketones? Groups with greater electron donating power corresponding to greater magnetic. So any group which has got electron donating power will be the one which will be migrating because of the increased ability to stabilize the positive charge in the transition state. So any group, so if you have to see in a group, if any group which is more electron donating will be migrating in, in the two. So general order of migration is what? Tertiary alkyl, cyclohexyl, secondary alcohol, benzyl, phenyl, primary alkyl and hydrogen. So this is your sodium borohydrate, the reagent. Sodium borohydrate is the next reagent that we are going to study. So it is an reducing agent. It is a selective reducing agent which reduces only your aldehydes and ketones. Which reduces your aldehyde and ketones into its corresponding alcohol. It does not reduce your esters, carboxylic acid, acyl chlorides, amide, cyanides, nothing. Only aldehydes and ketones. It is Na plus BH4. Okay, sodium plus and BH4 minus. This is how it is written. So this is the structure of your sodium borohydride. It contains the sodium, boron and four hydrogen atoms. Okay, now let's go for the mechanistic. How does this work? How does the sodium borohydride work? So they have got four hydrogens. Boron's valence is three. So one lone pair of electrons will be one vacant orbital will be filled by your hydrogen. So what happens? This and it gets a negative charge. Okay. Now one of the hydrogen is removed as an hydride ion. What is hydride ion? H minus. So H minus is called as hydride ion. This hydride ion, which takes the two electrons of the bond, covalent bond along with it, attacks on the carbonyl carbon. If you can see, the hydride ion attacks on your carbonyl carbon. In doing so, you get your O minus and you get your free boron. Okay? You get your free boron triad, BH3. Okay? Now, this alkoxide ion that is formed, so this is an alkoxide, any alkyl and oxygen O minus, that is called as alkoxide. This reacts with your acid or water because this workup is done in your dilute acid. So that will react with your water or and then acid to form your OH corresponding alcohol and you get your OH minus. Now what happens next? Now what happens in the basic medium? So the reactions are done in alcohol. Okay. So there is a solvation. There is an solvation of your dye, your borohydride ion, okay, that it gives. So you get your product is formed, your OH. Now this product that is formed in your end product, it is still a reducing agent. It is still active because it has got three more hydrogens which can act as a source of your hydride ions. It can still act as a source of hydride ion. Your OH minus of your ethanol will form, will connect, get attached. So this BH3 again will act as a reducing agent. Okay, will again act as a reducing agent. So now again this BH3 will be formed. It will give away one of the proton. Again the same thing will happen. So such step, three more things will attach and it will dissociate, and you get one borohydrate will reduce four of your carbonyl compounds, aldehydes and ketones. So one borohydrate, one mole of sodium borohydrate will reduce four moles of your corresponding aldehyde, because there are four hydrogen associated. So this is how sodium borohydrate acts. Okay, it gets solvated again. There will be an hydride ion, so the reaction will. So one mole of sodium borohydrate will reduce four moles of your corresponding aldehydes and ketone fluids alcohol. So now let's go for the mechanism. So sodium borohydrate is source of hydride ion H minus. Remember, sodium borohydride is a source of hydride H minus. That's very important to be known. The hydride then attacks, as I said, on the carbonyl carbon, forming an alkoxide ion. This alcohol is protonated by a dilute acid, because your workup is done in your dilute. Only reacts with the carbonyl of your aldehydes and ketones, but not carbonyl of your esters of a or a carboxyl. So only the carbonyl carbon of your aldehydes and ketones react with sodium borohydrate. No carboxylic acid or an ester reacts with sodium borohydrate. Okay, so this is the overall reaction that can be formed. Okay, this is the overall. You get your BH3, which can again further react to give your, so it can give. So this is the mechanism of sodium borohydrate. This is the mechanism of sodium. It is an hydride transfer. Remember, it is H minus that attacks on your carbonyl carbon. Okay, nucleophilic attack on your carbonyl carbon. Okay, and then it breaks open to liberate your alkoxide, which gets protonated by your water or your acidic medium, and you get your product. Okay, you get your product, that is your alcohol. So this was about sodium borohydrate. It is used for reduction of your aldehydes and ketones only. Remember, sodium borohydrate is used for reduction of aldehydes and ketones only. No other carbonyl group containing functional groups are reduced. Only aldehydes and ketones, esters, amides, alcohol, this acyl chloride, cyanides, amides are not reduced by your sodium borohydrate. Now the next example is your lithium aluminium hydride. Now next example is your lithium. So in this case also, aluminium is A3, Al, its valence is 3, but here there are 4 hydrogens which are attached to it and a lithium ion plus. Okay, AlH4 is how it is represented. Okay, now this is also so reducing agent, similar to that of your sodium borohydrate, yes, but it is a stronger used than your sodium borohydrate. It is stronger than your sodium borohydrate. It is more powerful owing to the weaker aluminium hydrogen bond compared to that of your boron. So there is more bond strength between your aluminium and hydrogen is less compared to that of, because aluminium is a little bit bigger in size, so the bonding is, so size matters in this thing, the strength of the bond. Boron is more tightly bound to your hydrogen, whereas in case of your aluminium it is less, so the bond is weak in comparison to your sodium, in comparison to your boron. Aluminium and hydrogen bonds are weak, that's why they are very reactive. They can easily donate your hydride ion, so they are a strong reducing agent. They are what? They are a strong reducing agent. Okay, they often used in as a solution in diethylated PHF, okay, followed by a acidic workup. So they'll be always given in the solution form. Basically, they'll be present in a solution form, in either in ether or PHF in a soluble form. It converts, now see the most important, it converts esters, carboxylic acid, acyl chlorides, aldehydes, ketone, amides to its corresponding alcohol. That's a major difference, because it's a strong reducing. It will reduce all the carbonyl groups. It will reduce all the carbonyl groups into its corresponding alcohols. That's a major difference between your sodium borohydride and lithium aluminum hydride. Lithium aluminum hydride is a strong reducing agent. It will reduce all the carbonyl groups into its corresponding ester. Similarly, it converts amides, nitro, nitrile, amine, oxam, azide into its corresponding amides. Okay, it will reduce its amide, nitro, nitrile, amines, oxymes, azide into its corresponding amine. So it's a very strong reducing agent. It can reduce anything which is present in your structure. Any group which is prone to your reduction will be reduced by your lithium aluminium hydride. That is LiAlH4. LiAhS4. Okay. Now, when epoxide are reduced using LiAh, the reagent attacks the less hindered end of your epoxide producing your secondary or tertiary. If it is an epoxide, it will attack from the less hindered because it is bulky. So it will attack only from the less hindered group and you get your corresponding secondary or tertiary alcohol. Okay, it will attack from the less hindered group and you get a corresponding secondary or a tertiary alcohol. It reduces quaternary ammonium cations into its corresponding tertiary amines. Even your quaternary ammonium salt also can be reduced to its corresponding tertiary amine. So these are the basic uses of your lithium aluminium. It can reduce every damn thing into its corresponding, if it is an ester, carbonyl group, esters and all to its corresponding alcohol, and the amides and nitros and nitriles into its corresponding amines, quaternary ammonium salt into its corresponding tertiary amines, and epoxide into its corresponding tertiary or a secondary alcohol. So these are the uses of lithium aluminium hydride. So as I said, lithium aluminium hydride, LiAlH4, it's a source of hydride similar to that of your sodium borohydride. Okay. It is strong reducing agent than your sodium, but dangerous to work with. It is very dangerous to work with. It is highly explosive. So you have to be very careful when you are handling the lithium aluminium. How do you add into the reaction? It should not get stuck to any of your walls of your glassware. Otherwise, it will blast. So you have to be very careful when you are adding this solution or the solid lithium aluminium hydride. You have to be very much careful. Okay, it reduces ketones into corresponding alcohols and converts esters and carboxylic acid into its corresponding primary alcohol. Into your corresponding primary alcohol. So these are the uses of your lithium aluminium. Now let's go for the mechanism of action. Of your lithium aluminium, how it reduces your esters into its corresponding alcohol. Now look at the both the sides. When on the right hand side, the mechanism is shown. So what is the first step? Nucleophilic hydride ion of from the reagents add across the electrophilic carbon of your polar carbonyl group of ester. So what happens? Your hydride ion attacks on the polar carbonyl carbon of your ester. Okay, that is the first step. H- attacks on your carbonyl carbon. So when it attacks, you get your corresponding, it will lead to a tetrahedral intermediate of metal alkoxide complex. So it will, once your hydride ion gets attacked, you get your corresponding tetrahedral, your trigonal sp2 hybridized gets converted to an sp3 hybridized alkoxide metal cation. Why? Your O- will attack on your lithium aluminium. So you get a metal alkoxide complex. What happens next? This metal alkoxide complex which is formed collapses and displaces your alcohol. So what happens? Your alcohol groups your alcohol group gets removed from your ester. Once when the tetrahedral intermediate breaks open, you get your alcohol gets removed. And you get your corresponding aldehyde from this. So what happens? Your ester is first converted to your aldehyde, okay, with the loss of your ethanol, okay, whatever the ester is, you will get an aldehyde. Now what happens? Now since this aldehyde is also prone to your reduction, again this lithium aluminum hydride will attack on your carbonyl carbon of your aldehyde. Okay, again your alkoxide is formed, metal alkoxide from tetraethyl. Again this breaks open, and this takes place in presence of an acid. The acid breaks open your metal alkoxide complex, and you get your corresponding alcohol, primary alcohol, and your intermediate complex is break. Your metal alkoxide complex is broken. So these are the step. It is a two-step reduction reaction. It is a two-step reaction. Okay. First step is your alkoxide formation. Second step is your loss of your alcohol to get an aldehyde. Again, this aldehyde contains a carbonyl group. So again, your lithium aluminum hydride, it again forms a tetrahedral chemistry, tetrahedral metal alkoxide complex. That breaks open in your acidic medium. That breaks open in your acidic medium to give you your primary alcohol. To give your primary alcohol. So this is the mechanism of action of your lithium aluminum. First step, alkoxide formation, attack of your hydride on your carbonyl carbon of your ester to give your corresponding tetrahedral metal alkoxide complex. So this breaks open with the loss of your ethanol or any alkoxide. Then what happens? What is the next step? You get your aldehyde. So this aldehyde also contains a carbonyl group. So lithium aluminum hydride again attacks on your carbonyl carbon. Okay, the hydride anhydride again attacks on your carbon. Again you got a tetrahedral metal alkoxide. In this case there are two hydrogens attached there. Then next step is when you do the acidic workup, that breaks your alkoxide transition state and you get your corresponding primary alcohol. You get your corresponding primary alcohol. This is how you convert an ester into an alcohol with the help of lithium aluminum. It is a two-step reaction. It is a two-step reduction. First step is reduction of your ester to your aldehyde with the loss of ethanol. And next other one is again attack of an hydride ion, and in the workup your tetrahedral intermediate is broken up to give you a corresponding alcohol. So this is the steps involved in your lithium aluminum hydride conversion to an alcohol, ester to an alcohol. Now let's go for the next one. Okay. So what is the thing that happens? Now look at this mechanism. It's completely different. Amine is not a good leaving group. So what happens over here? How to convert an amide to an amine using lithium aluminum hydride. So what is the first step? Hydride, here also hydride ion attacks similarly at the carbonyl carbon of your amide. Okay. Now electrons from your carbonyl move towards the electronegative oxygen, creating an tetrahedral metal alkoxide complex that is same, okay, as that of your ester. Now the tetrahedral image collapses, displaces the oxygen as a part of metal alkoxide. So nitrogen having a lone pair, it will give. So what happens? Your alkoxide, O alkoxide is removed and you get an imine intermediate. Imanium intermediate you get. See, N double bond NH2. Okay, this is an imanium intermediate. Okay, so there is a lot of loss of alkoxide over here. Okay. Imanium ion is, now again this imanium ion gets attacked by your lithium aluminum hydride, okay, and your H goes off, so you get your NH2, okay, your bond goes off, your nitrogen gets its lone pair of electrons, and thus your amide gets converted to an, your amine gets converted to an, amide gets converted to an amine, so nitrogen gets back his electron and it, the charge gets neutralized. So this is how your amide is converted to an amine using lithium aluminum hydride. So what is the intermediate formed over here is ammonium ion. I-M-I-U-M. Ammonium, imine is formed. three double bond NH. That is known as imine bond. That is formed. Okay. So this imanium ion then gets again attacked by your lithium aluminum hydride. There is a neutralization of charge. The nitrogen gets its lone pair of electron back, and thus your amide gets converted to an amine. Thus your amide gets converted to an amide. So this is the mechanism of action of your lithium aluminum hydride. Okay, that is conversion of amide. So what is the major intermediate that is formed is your imanium ion. Okay, N C double bond N NH2. And the next step is again attack of your, and there is a loss of alkoxide, metal alkoxide in this case. So this is the difference between reduction of your esters and your amides. Okay, so very important. Now reduce agent. So sodium borohydride, as you said, can only reduce aldehydes and ketones, but not esters. But your lithium aluminum hydride can reduce everything. And ease of reduction is, it is very easy to reduce aldehydes and ketones, but it is difficult to reduce esters, carboxylic acids, and so these are the reducing capacity of your sodium borohydride and lithium aluminum hydride. It will reduce all the groups containing carbonyl group. Okay, so it will reduce all the lithium aluminum hydride will reduce all the compounds containing carbonyl group into its corresponding amines or alcohols. The next reagent, okay, the next reagent that is used is diazomethane. Diazo means two nitrogen and a methane group, that is CH2. Okay, CH2, that is diazomethane. There is a charge on this. So nitrogen has got a positive charge. Diazo means nitrogen valence is 3, but when one more extra bond is formed, it gets positively charged and it is attached to a methylenium ion, CH2-. So your diazo, CN2, is connected to a methylenium ion, that is CH2-. That is known as diazomethane. There can be what? Delocalization of electron, and it, the nitrogen gets, in this case, these are the two resonance form of your diazo. Okay, the simplest diazomethane is diazo compound is diazomethane. In the pure form at room, it is extremely sensitive, explosive yellow gas. We have to be very careful when you are using this reagent. Even a slight crack in your beaker will blast your reaction. So it should be very careful when you are handling this reaction. Basically, it is present in your diethyl ether solution. They are popularly used as a methylating agent. Okay, they are popularly used as methylating, means if there is an alcohol acid converted into an methyl ester, alcohol to an ether. So methylated ethers can be converted by using your diazomethane. It converts your carboxylic acid into methyl ester and into their homologous. See, so it is also used in Buchner-Curtius-Schotterbeck's reaction, where diazonium salt reacts with aldehyde to form homologous ketone. So you convert your aldehydes into a CH2 ketone. So this is the mechanism. So diazomethane CH3 reacts with your ketones to give your homologous, means one CH2 extra to that. You are trying to introduce an methylenic group, extra methylenic group into that. That is known as homologous, introduction of your CH2 group inside your aldehydes or ketones. That is known as your homologous. Okay, so introduction of your CH2, your CH2 keeps on increasing in further step. Now let us go for Buchner-Curtius-Schotterbeck's reaction. Buchner-Curtius-Schotterbeck's reaction, very important. So what is this reaction? In this reaction, aldehydes and ketone react with aliphatic diazoalkanes, okay, CH2-methane or any other diazoalkane, to form a homologated ketone, that is introduction of an CH2 group into that. Okay, this was described by Edward Buchner and Theodor Curtius, you know, that's why, and Fritz Gutenberg. That's why this name has come. Now let us go for the reaction. In this case, an aldehyde or a ketone, R1 and R2 are H. R2 is what? R2 is H and R3 is H. R4 is H. Okay, it is a diazomethane. R1 is any alkyl group. Okay, now that reacts with diazomethane to form an homologate. There is an introduction of CH2 group inside in between your carbonyl group. So one CH2 is formed. So this are the products that can be formed from your aldehyde. So either it on the right hand side or on the left hand side. Okay, so these are the two products that can be formed. Okay, so this is an example. So it gets homologate, means introduction of your CH2 group, where R3 and R4 is H. R3 and R4 is H. So that is CH2N2. Okay, that is R3 and R4 is CH2. So remember that. Now let's go for the, so you can get an epoxide also as an intermediate for, with the loss of nitrogen atom. Okay, now we'll go for the mechanism. So what is the first general mechanism? The resonating arrow shows the resonating contribution of your diazo compound with a lone pair of electrons on the carbon adjacent to the nitrogen. So what you see, when you draw the resonating structure, we see that the carbon which is adjacent to your nitrogen gets a negative charge. That is, it gets two electrons on it. Okay, that means it acts as a nucleophile. When the charge, when the carbon gets a negative charge, it acts as a nucleophile. Okay, when the carbon gets a lone pair of electrons from this during the resonating structure, its negative charge increases. So they act as a nucleophile. This diazo compound then does attacks on the carbonyl carbon. Nucleophilic addition takes place. This CH2 carbon acts on the carbonyl carbon of your aldehyde or a ketone. Okay, so it gives you a tetrahedral intermediate. So this attacks on this, so you get a tetrahedral intermediate. That is your second step. Okay, second intermediate is your tetrahedral. You see, there is an tetrahedral intermediate. Okay, you get an diazo compound tetrahedral intermediate. Now what happens in the third step? There is a loss of nitrogen. When there is a loss of nitrogen atom, the carbon atom, okay, the carbon atom on the diazomethane gets positive charge. Okay, gets positive charge. Okay, so that gets positive charge. There is a tertiary carbocationism. Now what will be the form? So what is the next step? Next step. Now let us go for the fourth step. So the reaction is completed either by reformation of your carbonyl group 1-2 rearrangement. So there can be a migration from the first carbon to the second carbon. One of the carbon from the attached to the first carbon will migrate to the second carbon. That is your methylenic carbon. So one of the carbon, one of the substitution from the first carbon will get migrated to the newly formed carbonyl tertiary carbon. So this are, there will be two problems. Either R1 or R2 will migrate to the formed tertiary carbon. Okay, these are the one. And the another step is, there can be the oxygen will attack on the carbonyl to form your epoxide. So these are the three. So there will be either migration of R1 or R2 on the tertiary carbon atom, or there will be an nucleophilic attack of your oxygen on your tertiary carbocation to form an epoxide. So these are the three possible products that can be formed from an reaction. So epoxide is an example for intramolecular addition reaction with a lone pair of interaction of that which attacks on your carbocation. So these are the three products that you get from your intermediates. Okay, from your tetrahedral carbocation. So either there will be a rearrangement, 1-2 rearrangement. So the carbon, the group attached to the first carbon, either one of them will move towards the carbocation, either R1 or R2, to get the two alcohol corresponding carbonyl carbons, homologated ketones, or it will get converted to an epoxy. So these are the probable products that can be formed from this particular reactions. Okay, these are the probable structures that can be formed in this reaction. So what is this? Either in this case, if you see, either R1 or R2 gets migrated towards your carbon, which is attached to this, and your epoxide will be. So this is how your homologated means introduction of your CH2 group, and it will keep on increasing further. Okay, so this is known as homologated ketones. Why ketones? Because your ketones will be formed. Any aldehyde or ketones will form either a homologated ketone, because the end product is a ketone because of the introduction of your CH2 group in between the two carbonyl, in between the carbonyl and your CH2. So this is known as Buchner-Curtius-Schotterbeck's reaction.